Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to Driving Forces, 100 plus years of women influencing, buying, designing, and driving automobiles. My name is Barbara Barrett, and I'm a history entertainment speaker. That is, I love sharing history in an entertaining way. I'll be your host as we explore the lesser known, but no less fascinating of women in the automotive industry. We'll begin with early pioneers, the damsels of design, the need for speed women in motorsports, guardians of safety, and we'll wrap it up with where women are today in the industry. So let's begin with our first pioneer, Bertha Benz. She was the first woman to take a long distance ride in a horseless carriage. Now, how did this lovely young lady make automotive history? Well, in 1849, she was born into a wealthy family in Pforzheim, Germany. And at the age of 23, she was engaged to and married Carl Benz, pictured here on the right. And for all intents and purposes, it was a very happy marriage, and their family grew quickly. As for Carl, he was an ambitious college-educated engineer. And in 1877, he established the Benz & Cie Company in Mannheim, Germany, with financial support from Bertha's dowry. And this will become critical in her long-distance drive. In 1885, just 7 years after he started the company, Carl achieved his lifelong dream of building a horseless carriage, the first internal combustion powered vehicle, the Motorwagen Model 1. He submitted and obtained his patent in 1886. However, Carl was a perfectionist, and he was not pleased with the first public displays of his Motorwagen. Now, as you can see here, it's a rather primitive automobile compared to today's automobiles. But in 1886, this was cutting edge. So he took his Motorwagen back into the shop and tinkered with it endlessly. Well, this led to quite a bit of frustration for Bertha for several reasons. First of all, she truly believed in proof of concept. She thought if you could get that Motorwagen out onto the street where people could view it, they would be interested in purchasing it. And secondly, she also knew that Gottlieb Daimler was working on a horseless carriage, and she wanted to make sure Carl's invention made it to the marketplace before Gottlieb's. And third, but not least, of course, her dowry underwrote the finances of the Benz & Cie Corporation. So she had a vested interest in it succeeding. So she took matters into hand. An early one August morning in 1888, Bertha set out with her sons on a trip from Mannheim to Pforzheim to draw attention to Carl's Motorwagen and prove its potential. She left Carl a note on the kitchen table. She didn't discuss it with him. And the note read something like, "Went to visit mother. We'll see you soon." So she and her sons took the Motorwagen out of the shop and started it up. And this is what it might have sounded like. Well, in 1888, when her historic ride took place, roads were rocky, muddy, dusty, and unpaved. And gas stations or service stations, as we know them today, were non-existent. So this was Bertha's path. She started in Mannheim, went through all these towns, and ended up in Pforzheim. And on her return trip, she took a bit of a different path because she wanted as many people to see the Motorwagen as possible. For the 65-mile journey, she planned her trip through villages with apothecaries where she could purchase petroleum-based cleaning fluid as fuel. She served as both driver and mechanic on this journey. She used a hat pin to clean a clogged fuel line, and she used her garter as an insulator when ignition wires short-circuited. Well, she also had to convince a cobbler to install leather soles as brake pads when the original wood brakes wore down. And the terrain being uneven as it was, she had her boys jump out and push the Motorwagen up some steep inclines. And that ultimately led to Carl adding a low gear to the transmission for hill climbing. Well, upon arriving at her mother's home 12 hours after she started, Bertha sent Carl a telegram. But news of her journey and her exploit had already reached the press, and Carl was well aware. It was quite a sight to see an automobile on the road, let alone one driven by a woman. Well, what did Carl think of all this? Although he didn't exactly agree with Bertha's tactics, he could not disagree with the outcome. Her round trip unleashed an avalanche of publicity, resulting in numerous orders for their newfangled contraption. And within a decade, before 1900, Carl's company became the world's largest automobile company with a full-time staff of over 400 employees. And the Benz Corporation is one of the oldest and most successful automobile companies in the world today. And if you go to Germany, you can retrace Bertha's route. There is the Bertha Benz Memorial Route. It's a 125-mile journey, which follows the path of her historic trip. And it's interesting to know that the Benz Corporation today is using this path, her Bertha Benz Memorial Route, to test their autonomous driving vehicles. Unfortunately, the Motorwagen, the original, did not survive. But at the 100-year anniversary, Benz Corporation authorized several replicas to be built and to be put on display in various museums. One is very close here to Chicagoland at the Volvo Auto Museum in Volo, Illinois. There's also one at the Gilmore Car Museum in Hickory Corners, Michigan. And here's a photograph of that one, which I took when my husband and I visited there a couple years ago, and unfortunately missed by just one day. An exhibition of early automobiles. They actually had the Motorwagen out on the grounds and driving about. Now, to be an authorized replica, you have to build it to the same specifications that Carl Benz used to obtain his patent. And secondly, it has to be operational. It can't just be a museum piece. It has to be able to be driven at any moment. Well, what about Carl? He passed in 1929, but Bertha lived to the ripe old age of 95. Carl was inducted into the Automotive Hall of Fame in 1984, and Bertha was inducted in 2016, making them the first married couple ever inducted into the Automotive Hall of Fame. And we'll speak more about the Automotive Hall of Fame as we journey through the presentation. Next, we come to our second pioneer, Alice Hyler Ramsey, which I would bet most of you haven't heard of. She was the first woman to drive across the United States and the first woman inducted into the Automotive Hall of Fame. Now, she was born in 1886 to a very wealthy family in Hackensack, New Jersey. And in 1903, at the age of 16, she was sent off to Vassar College in Poughkeepsie, New York. She graduated in 1906 with a bachelor's degree. And that same year, she became a bride. She married John Rathbone Ramsey. Now, John was several years senior to Alice, but both families had known each other for a very long time. Both families were in favor of the match, and John, for all intents and purposes, adored his young wife. Alice was quite a sportswoman. She wasn't satisfied just to go to society luncheons and fundraisers. And she enjoyed equestrian sports. But when she was nearly thrown from her horse in 1907, when it got spooked by a passing automobile, her husband said, well, rather than beat him, let's join him. And he purchased her a two-seater Maxwell Roadster, which she just loved. And here is an artist rendering of that vehicle. Well, don't you know? Before long, Alice was seen driving all over New Jersey in her Roadster. And she was doing so well, she decided to enter road races. And in September 1908, Alice, pictured here on the right, and her friend Joan Cuneo, the only two ladies, took part in the Montauk Point Reliability Tour. And that's a 200-mile race from Lynbrook, Long Island, to the eastern tip of Long Island and back. Now, this is over surface roads. But in 1908, this journey took 2 days and was 200 miles. on mostly unimproved and treacherous roads, dotted with mud and chuck holes. Now here's a modern atlas showing that today's drive, it would take you 3 hours and 45 minutes to get from Lindbrook, Long Island, out to Montauk Point State Park. But as I say, in 1908, it was a very different story, especially considering the road conditions. But Alice finished the two-day event with a perfect score and a bronze medal. And instead of wearing her medal around her neck or on her lapel, she attached it to her hat, and she wore it proudly. Well, once this got out to the Maxwell Briscoe Motor Company that she had won this race driving a Maxwell, she was approached by Carl Kelsey, who was head of Maxwell Briscoe Motor Company, with the offer, Alice, how would you like to be the first woman to drive across the United States to inspire women to take up motoring, and preferably in a Maxwell? Well, don't you know, it took Alice probably a New York second to agree to the 3,800-mile journey from New York City to San Francisco, California. And here's the route she traveled: New York to Albany, Buffalo, Toledo, Chicago, Sioux City, Cheyenne, Salt Lake City, Reno, Sacramento, and eventually arriving in San Francisco. So on June 9th, 1909, the Intrepid Foursome, as they became known, which included the 22-year-old Alice Ramsey, her good friend Hermione, and her two sister-in-laws, who served as chaperones, of course, they set out from New York City on a cross-country adventure in a dark green 1909 Maxwell touring car. Now, the Maxwell Briscoe Motor Company financed her tour. They gave her a brand new Maxwell. They arranged for supplies, food, hotel accommodations, and publicity events, such as receptions and rallies along her route at various dealerships. They also arranged for a reporter from the Boston Herald to travel ahead of Alice by train and to stop at various points so that he could chronicle Alice's entire drive. This was a big story in the press. And she even stopped in Chicago on South Michigan Avenue, which at the time was known as Chicago's Motor Row. Well, the Intrepid Foursome really did have quite a journey ahead of them. They had only one driver, which was Alice. They had to clean spark plugs and change tires more than a dozen times, as Alice is doing right here in this photograph. However, she did get her traveling companions to assist in carrying water from ditches to replace water in the boiled out radiator. But what was their biggest obstacle? Road conditions, obviously. Back in 1909, most roads in the United States looked like this. They were unimproved, they were not paved, they were dirt roads, and when it rained, well, look out, you had a muddy mess. Also, she had to navigate without signage or road maps. There were no road atlases at that time. But what Alice figured out is if she took roads that were adjacent to telegraph wires or to railroad tracks, she knew she'd get to the next town. When they were traveling in Nebraska, they were surrounded by a sheriff's posse. Couldn't figure out what laws they had broken. But the sheriff just wanted to inform them that there was a killer on the loose and to be careful. By the time they made it to Wyoming, they encountered a group of Native Americans out hunting jackrabbits. This, of course, gave them pause. But they were just interested in seeing the automobile and were quite fascinated that it was being driven by a woman. Well, Alice and her traveling companions covered the 3,800-mile journey in 59 days. They arrived in San Francisco on August 7, 1909, to cheering crowds, flower bouquets, and an adoring press. For the return trip, however, they took the train back east. But what happened to Alice? Well, her husband was elected to Congress for two terms. She and her husband had two children, John and Alice. She published a book in 1916, which chronicled her adventure. It was entitled Veil, Duster, and Tire Iron. And during the course of her lifetime, she repeated the cross-country journey many times. She just enjoyed motoring. But in 1983, she passed away at the age of 96. And in 2000, she became the first woman inducted into the Automotive Hall of Fame. As for the Maxwell Briscoe Motor Company, which you may not have ever heard of, they doubled their sales in 1909 and employed a female sales force. They put Alice's original Maxwell on display at various dealerships, and they exchanged it and gave Alice a brand new Maxwell. But unfortunately, by 1926, it wasn't enough. And the Maxwell Briscoe Company was absorbed by the Chrysler Corporation. Next, we come to what we affectionately know as the damsels of design, women who worked in the design industry of automobiles. And one of the first and most successful was Helene Rother Akernecht. She was the first female automotive designer at the General Motors Corporation. Now, her life before, during, and after her time as an automotive designer was fascinating. She was born in 1908 in Leipzig, Germany. And by 1930, she graduated from the Royal Academy of Graphic and Book Arts in Leipzig, which is the equivalent of a master's degree today. She was immediately employed as a book illustrator, but by the mid-1930s, the winds of war were blowing across Germany. And she knew that it was imperative that she and her daughter flee Germany. They first stopped in France, hoping to be safe there and to take up residence. But of course, France was occupied, and she fortunately was able to escape to New York City. Well, once she arrived there, she again worked as a book illustrator, particularly for children's books. And she also was a jewelry designer. But in 1942, she saw an ad in the New York Times for a designer of fashioned interiors at General Motors. She had no idea what General Motors was, but she prepared a letter and sent in her portfolio, applying for the job of designer of fashioned interiors. She was immediately hired by Harley Earl, who was the vice president of styling at General Motors at the time. And during the 1940s, during her time there, she supervised, designed, and updated the interiors of all General Motor brands, including Buick, Chevrolet, Cadillac, Oldsmobile, and Pontiac. She took one look at their drab interiors and thought, why not make cars beautiful? She made many contributions to the interior design of many automobiles, but her most notable one is the 1948 Cadillac. Here you see on the left-hand side is the 1947 Cadillac. Now, here's the instrument panel, which is the dashboard, of course, and all of these instruments are displayed. But by 1948, based on Helene's design, they were all integrated into what we call an instrument pod. And that's pretty much the standard for automobiles even today. In 1947, she opened a design studio in Detroit, which allowed her to consult with other automobile manufacturers, such as Nash Kelvinator. In 1953, she worked on a project with the famed Italian coach car designer, Pininfarina, to design the aerodynamic Ambassador Air Flight Statesman. She and Pinin won the Jackson Award for Design in 1953. And here's an actual photograph of that car. Now, this was considered cutting edge, an aerodynamic styling based on cues from aviation. She also branched out to design non-automotive related products, such as furniture. And at the height of her career, she took a sabbatical and returned to France so that she could study stained glass art. When she came back to the United States, she designed windows in churches and cathedrals all around Detroit. Helene passed away in 1999 at the age of 91, and she was inducted into the Automotive Hall of Fame just a few years ago in 2020. Here's Helene and Pininfarina at an auto show in Europe. Well, because Helene's tenure at GM was so successful that led Harley Earl, pictured here on the right, to hire an entire female design team to work for General Motors. He recognized that women in the post-war era had a key role in car purchasing decisions. So he got the green light to recruit female graduates from prestigious industrial design colleges such as the Pratt Institute in Brooklyn, New York. Now, he had in mind to have them design for four areas of General Motors. First, automobile interiors for all GM brands, show displays and exhibits, the kitchen of tomorrow. GM at that time had their an appliance division, Frigidaire. And they also had the electromotive division, which designed passenger trains of tomorrow. And General Motors was very proud of their female design team. They even put out a newsreel. Let's pause here and give a look and listen.
The fair sex of America strikes again, this time in the nation's auto industry, where women designers have opened up a whole new field of employment. Here in the styling studios of General Motors, they select fabrics, colors, accessories, and help design cars inside and out. Today's modern woman, no longer just a voice from the back seat, has the last word in the purchase of 7 out of 10 cars. So the feminine taste is represented by these girls, a few of the many damsels of design. As a project report, these designing women hold a private showing for top executives. This champagne white is trimmed with pearls. A notepad in the glove compartment for thoughts while waiting. If it's a dark, overcast day, these talented designers are prepared. In fact, they've already led the way with six-way seats, easy-to-reach dashboard controls, and upholstery that won't snag their nylons. A lift-out vanity for last-minute face fixing. These young experts were acclaimed by the men for their artistic ingenuity. Significant since the man usually pays the bill. Female auto designers were first employed 15 years ago by GM Vice President Harley Earl, who predicts that soon women will design an entire car.
Interesting. Well, as part of their work, Harley Earl staged the 1958 Spring Fashion Festival of Women Design Cars, and it became also known as the Feminine Auto Show. It was held at the GM Tech Center Dome in Warren, Michigan, and it showcased the damsel's taste and design prowess. Now, he was very proud of his design team. There was mutual respect between the ladies and Harley Earl and vice versa. And I'd like to share some of their work with you. Here's one of the members of the design team, Ruth Glennie. She was considered the Steve Wozniak of her time. She made significant design contributions to the interior of Chevrolet, Pontiac, and Oldsmobile. And for the fancy free Corvette, she designed for the 1958 Feminine Auto Show. And here it is pictured on the right. But here's a better view of it. It was a beautiful silver olive Corvette. Now, what she introduced was retractable seat belts using a pneumatic roller system, which is pretty much the norm today. She replaced standard reflectors at the base of the interior door panels with flashing lamps and designed a storage area for purse. She had four interchangeable seat fabrics and leather to reflect the seasons of the year. Our next designer was Janet Linder. Now, she and her husband, Peter, were seniors at the Pratt Institute in New York, when they were approached by General Motors to join the design team of General Motors upon graduation. It's kind of interesting, at that time, Jeanette, she did not even know how to drive. But once she and her boyfriend graduated, they soon tied the knot and arrived in Detroit and were hired on the spot by Harley Earl himself. Now, interestingly enough, Jeanette was assigned to design for the Chevrolet division. And Peter, her husband, was assigned to design for the Frigidaire or appliance division to design wash machines. For the 1958 auto show, she designed the Impala Martinique. Now, once again, women designers at that time were limited to the interior of the vehicle, but that's a lot of real estate. You have to think about, there's the dashboard, there's the upholstery, the inside door panels, the carpeting, and also the trunk space for which she designed matching luggage. She also introduced the lighted vanity mirror, and where would we be without it? Even though it wasn't put into production for many years. Next, we come to Marjorie Pullman. She designed for the Buick division. And for the 58 Feminine Auto Show, she designed this striking royal purple Buick Shalimar. And she featured a dictaphone installed right into the dashboard of the car, so executives could record their voice on the way and have their secretaries transcribe it upon arrival in the office. So efficiency and no waste of time. Next, we come to Margaret Elizabeth Sauer, affectionately known as Peg. She was assigned to the Oldsmobile division. And for the Feminine Auto Show, she designed the Oldsmobile Carousel Station Wagon with a child-friendly back seat, also child-proof window and door latches. Now, you wouldn't think a child-friendly back seat would be that important, but Peck knew that station wagons would be purchased usually by families, large families, and families with children, of course. So before handheld devices, before tablets, before cell phones, you had to occupy children for those long journeys. And this was Peg's solution. Now, Susan Vanderbilt was another member of the design team. She designed for Chevy and Cadillac. And for the Feminine Auto Show, she designed the interiors for the Cadillac Saxony and the Cadillac Baroness concept cars. She also introduced, believe it or not, in 1958, a car phone, which became pretty much standard in many vehicles as time progressed, but not for many years, of course. And that eventually evolved in what we know as our cell phones today. Susan Vanderbilt also, during the latter part of her career at GM, designed and patented the lumbar adjustable seat. Well, unfortunately, shortly after that show was held, Harley Earl had to retire from the General Motors Corporation. It was the policy of GM that once you reached the age of 65, it was mandatory retirement. So the female design team, having lost their greatest supporter, were dismissed from the company ranks. Harley Earl's successor, Bill Mitchell, dismissed all of them except for Susan Vanderbilt. And she actually took a sabbatical, went on for advanced study, and returned to GM to work in the ergonomics division. Now we come to the need for speed, women in motorsports. And here is the first lady of firsts, Betty Skelton, which you may or may not know her. But you, once you hear what her career was like, you'll never forget her. She was the first woman issued a racing driver's license by the AAA, and the first woman inducted into more than 10 aviation and motorsports halls of fame, including in 1983, the NASCAR International Hall of Fame, in 2001, the Corvette Hall of Fame, and in 2008, the Motorsports Hall of Fame. But how did she begin her journey in automotive history? Well, she began in aviation. She began as an aerobatic pilot, taking her first solo flight in 1938 at the age of 12. Now, she grew up in Pensacola, Florida, adjacent to a naval base, and she was fascinated by planes all day long. Her parents were young as well, and they also were interested in aviation, so they encouraged their daughter. So Betty Skelton obtained her driver's aviation license at the age of 12, her private pilot's license at the age of 16, and a commercial pilot's license when she was 18. And in 1948, 49, and 50, she was the U.S. female aerobatic champion In her special little stinker plane, pictured here on the right. This plane is actually on display at the Smithsonian Institute in Washington. But by 1951, at the age of 25, she retired from the aerobatic championship circuit. But she didn't retire from aviation. She worked for a commercial charter aviation line. And in 1954, she received a call from Minister Bill France. He wanted someone to transport by charter some race car drivers from Pennsylvania to the race team. And she was approached by Bill France. He was very surprised to get Betty Skelton on the phone, and even more surprised to learn she would be the pilot to transport the drivers. He also invited her to come to Daytona for Speed Week, which she accepted that challenge. And she set a woman's stock car flying mile record of 106 miles an hour in a red Ram Hemi equipped Dodge, which she's sitting on here. She was hired as Detroit's first female test driver for Chrysler Corporation. Well, her career really took off. And by 1956, she joined the Campbell Ewald Advertising Agency and became its first official spokesperson for the Chevrolet brand. Some of you might remember a little jingle or song that went, "See the USA in your Chevrolet," that Dinah Shore made rather famous. Well, that was Betty's idea. She set a new woman's land speed record driving a Chevy Corvette at 145 miles an hour, right on the beach. She showcased the all-new 1956 Corvette during the Daytona Speed Week. And in her free time, she took a transcontinental speed record drive of 2,913 miles from New York City to LA in 56 hours and 59 minutes, a little shorter than Alice's drive. She became the first woman to drive a pace car at the annual Daytona 500 in a unique translucent gold Corvette, which was commissioned by Harley Earl and Bill Mitchell. But this photograph really doesn't even do it justice. But Betty knew that she would not be able to participate in sanctioned motorsports and races. But she thought, what else can I do? Well, in 1959, NASA invited her to undergo the same physical and psychological tests given to the Mercury astronauts. And she certainly took up the challenge. She thought it was important to show that women could take the same training and pass the same tests that gentlemen would do in order to become astronauts, because she knew eventually that would pave the way for a female astronaut. And here's the astronauts to Betty from the Mercury astronauts. Welcome aboard our two-seater. And she also converted all of the astronauts into Corvette owners. And in 1976, Betty retired from the Campbell Ewald Advertising Agency. At that time, she was head of the women's marketing and advertising departments. She and her husband retired to the Villages in Florida. Some of you might be familiar with that community. And you know, people do get about there in a golf cart. But she continued to drive her Corvette convertible into her 80s. And she passed away in August 2011. Now, she had a fantastic career. And I've actually kind of skimmed over it. So let's hear a little bit from Betty herself.
Successful women know there was someone before them, a trailblazer who pushed the limits and created a path for future generations to establish new thresholds for success.
I can see the future painted in my eyes.
It's shocking that we don't know her name.
She was the fastest woman in the world.
In the 1950s, Betty Skelton pushed NASCAR to new heights As the first female licensed race car driver, Betty set countless records on Daytona Beach alongside legends Lee Petty, Fireball Roberts, and Buck Baker.
I had a charter flight to fly three famous race drivers for Bill France Sr., who then was just getting NASCAR started. He said, how would you like to come down to Daytona for Speed Week? And I said, well, what is Speed Week? He explained to me what NASCAR was doing with Speed in Daytona. And I said, well, sure, I'd love to come, but I'd have to have a sponsor. Oh, 6 months later, he called and said, I have you a sponsor. The speed, I think it was somewhere around 143, 44 miles an hour, the average speed. It was a new record for women.
She immediately makes headlines. She breaks a speed record right away.
She was an amazing competitive person. I can't imagine what it must be like to be in the top of your profession. People just laugh at you because, well, you're a woman. I'm sorry, you can't. No, we don't allow women. Yeah, but I just broke the record. Yep, sorry. It's great you broke the record, but we can't recognize. And I just can't imagine what it must be like going through life like that.
Betty Skelton's accomplishments rewarded her with honors in 10 halls of fame, spanning across aviation and motorsports. Fearless and determined, gifted with skill and charm, everything Betty accomplished forged a path for the newest heroines of NASCAR.
So Betty was a true influencer, as well as accomplishing many firsts, but she was not jaded by the life and times in which she lived. And she was a gracious and beautiful woman and paved the way for female race car drivers such as Denise McCluggage. Denise is the only woman inducted into the Sebring International Raceway Hall of Fame. She's the first and the only automotive journalist inducted into the Automotive Hall of Fame. Her trademark was a white helmet with pink dots, and she's pictured here on the left. Well, what was her journey like to the racetrack? Well, she graduated in 1947 from Mills College in Oakland, California. She had a degree in philosophy, and she began her career as a journalist for the San Francisco Chronicle. Now, she wanted to cover sporting events because she herself was very athletic and enjoyed sports. She wanted to cover not only sports, but extreme sports, like skydiving. But the San Francisco Chronicle assigned her to cover society luncheons and those types of events. Well, that kind of frustrated Denise. And she turned to apply for a position at the New York Herald Time Tribune in 1954. So once she arrived in New York, she was able to take up professional car racing. Well, just how did that happen? When she moved to New York, she moved into Greenwich Village. And there she met a myriad of different folks, such as Stirling Moss, a famous British race car driver. She also met people who were musicians, such as Allen Iger. And he'll play into the story in a few moments. And she was also romantically linked to this race car driver. You might know as Steve McQueen. Well, Denise began her race car driving through the Sports Car Club of America. She began to move up into the rankings, and she was able to qualify for the Sebring race in 1961. And she drove a Ferrari and won the Grand Touring category. Now, that's a 12-hour race, the Sebring race. So you do need a relief driver at some point. And of course, she selected that musician she came to know, Allen Iger. Well, in the late 1960s, her professional car racing career was winding down. But she originally was a journalist, and she looked towards that as a profession again. She authored numerous columns for Auto Week, which she helped launch in 1958, and she published them as a collection in a book entitled By Brooks Too Broad for Leaping. She also wrote Are You a Woman Driver? She was inducted into the Automotive Hall of Fame in 2001, not as a race car driver, but as the first and only journalist. She passed away in 2015 at the age of 88. She herself was very philosophical and enjoyed a full and exciting life. And here's one of her quotes. Now, when I was preparing this presentation, I wanted to make sure I included the first woman who participated in the Daytona 500, the first woman who drove in the Indy 500 race, and the first woman to drive in a Winston Cup race. And to my great delight and surprise, I found all three of those women in one. Janet Guthrie. She was the first woman to compete in the Indy 500, the Daytona 500, and a NASCAR Winston Cup event. But what was her journey like? She too began in aviation. At the age of 17, she earned her pilot's license. Now her parents too were private pilots, encouraged her to take up aviation. She graduated from the University of Michigan in 1960 with a bachelor's degree in physics. Interesting for a woman at that time. Upon graduation, she was hired by Republic Aviation, where she worked as an aerospace engineer for 6 years. She also qualified for the scientist astronaut program of NASA, but she was disqualified when a doctorate was made one of its requirements. So what was Janet left with? She knew she couldn't be a commercial pilot. She knew that she could not be a military pilot. She knew that she wasn't going to be an astronaut. So what was left and what would satisfy her need for speed? Race car driving, of course. And in 1963, Janet began racing with the Sports Car Club of America in her own personal car, a Jaguar XK140. She was very successful and a skilled driver and moved up in the rankings. And by 1972, she was racing full-time, making an earning a living race car driving. And in 1977, she was the first woman to compete in the Daytona 500. She didn't win that race. She finished 12th, and she earned the honor of top rookie in the race. Well, what about this accomplishment? Let me just step back and say, in order to qualify for one of these top racing events, such as Daytona or the Indy 500, is a great accomplishment in and of itself. And what do you need to be able to participate in the race? Well, first of all, you have to be a crackerjack and skilled driver, which Janet undoubtedly was. You have to have a fantastic vehicle, one supported by an entire crew. And you also have to have money. Either you're independently wealthy, you also, or maybe employed by an automotive manufacturer's racing team, or you need a sponsor. And in Janet's case, her sponsor was Kelly Girl. And following her Daytona 500 debut, she qualified to participate in the Indy 500, the greatest spectacle in racing. She didn't win this race either, but she did finish it. She was 29th out of a field of 33. In 1980, she was inducted into the Women's Sports Hall of Fame. In 2005, she published her autobiography. Now, it was not ghostwritten. She actually wrote it. It's entitled Janet Guthrie, A Life at Full Throttle. In 2006, she was inducted into the International Motorsports Hall of Fame. And in 2019, into the Automotive Hall of Fame. Her helmet and driver's suit are on display in the Smithsonian Institution. Now, let's hear a few words from Janet herself.
It was clear to me that I really enjoyed NASCAR, but it took longer to become accepted in NASCAR Cup racing. It took solidly into 1977.
I always wondered what it would be like. You got all these men, and you show up and you're the only woman in the field. It has to be an odd feeling. I kind of went out of my way to help her because the thing I liked about her most, she was committed. She just wanted to drive a race car.
I drove Janet's car in at Bristol. She was under the weather, and I do remember very well, like it was yesterday, lapping cars that were basically riding around trying to finish the race. And I remember with my car, they would always move out of the way, very courteous. They would get to the inside and give me the racetrack. And I was driving Janet, 68 green Kelly Girl car. And I'm coming up on those same cars, and they would not get out of my way. I had to run up, bump a couple of them, you know, and move them out of the way, and they'd shake their fist at me, and, you know, they're thinking I'm Janet in the car. And I thought that day when I finished, I said, man, this poor woman, she's racing twice as hard as everybody else because, you know, nobody wanted to be passed by a girl.
There's an expression for women who have worked in sport that you have to be twice as good to get half the amount of credit. And I think that that expression applies here in just how amazing it was for Janet to be successful in both open wheel and stock car at a time when women weren't considered to be able to do it at all.
In 1977, I was the first woman to make the field for the Daytona 500 and also the first woman to make the field for the Indianapolis 500. And that wasn't what I was interested in. I was interested in winning the races, but I knew that if I screwed up, another woman wasn't going to get a chance for a long time.
What a gracious lady, paving the way for future female race car drivers. We next meet Shirley Muldowney. Now, she has an interesting journey to the racetrack. No, she didn't come from money. She was not college educated. As a matter of fact, she quit high school at the age of 16. She was born in Schenectady, New York in 1940. And she had a challenging nature, which was in fact due to her father, who was a former prize fighter. So in defiance as a teenager, she quit school at the age of 16 and married her boyfriend. Well, she and Jack initially entered drag racing competitions for fun. But lo and behold, Shirley was quite skillful. She was winning races, even beating her husband. Well, Shirley just looked at it as a way to pass time. She'd prefer racing to cooking or cleaning the house. But lo and behold, she became the first woman to obtain a Top Fuel license in 1973, even though the National Hot Rod Association, NHRA, fought her every inch of the way. Now, there might be reasons why NHRA gave her some resistance. First of all, when you get a Top Fuel license, you are able to drive vehicles that are going 200, 300 miles an hour. It's a dangerous business for anyone, male or female. But the NHRA backed off. Once they saw how a female race car driver could fill the stands at racing events, her hot pink car, pink cowboy boots, and diminutive stature attracted mostly positive attention. She won the NHRA Top Fuel Championship in 1977, the only female in the race. She won three NHRA championships and 17 other national competitions by 1983. Unfortunately, by 1984, she was seriously injured in a near-fatal crash in Canada. And this is a photograph taken immediately after the crash, just seconds after it. You see her engine flying through the air, and also wheels and tires off the car flying. She wasn't expected to even survive the crash. But after several surgeries and months of rehab and determination, she recovered and raced again. She was inducted into the International Motorsports Hall of Fame in 2004 and the Automotive Hall of Fame in 2005. And here's a picture of Shirley right here on the right. But the thing she regretted most about her accident was not how it put her out of the running, so to speak, for several months while she recovered. She was really most upset by the fact she could no longer wear spike high heels due to her injuries. And if you visit the Don Garlitz Museum of Drag Racing in Ocala, Florida, which is not too far from the Villages in Florida, you can view this beautiful display dedicated to Shirley Muldowney. Now, as well as driving and designing and influencing the automotive industry, we have advocacy in the arena of safety. And women were the guardians of safety, beginning with Dr. June Robertson McCarroll. And how would you figure a physician would be involved in automotive safety? Well, Dr. Robertson McCarroll was a home local gal. She attended medical college in Chicago here and moved to Southern California in 1904 after she graduated from medical school. Now, she got the idea to paint a line down the middle of the road when she was forced off the road by a truck in 1917 while she was driving her Model T to her office in Indio, California. She thought it made perfect sense. But her brilliant idea was ignored by the local Chamber of Commerce. So she took matters in hand and she actually painted a white line down the middle of the road. And in 1924, her idea was adopted by the California Highway Commission. And today it's the standard worldwide. And if you visit Indio, California, in the Coachella Valley, you will find this beautiful plaque in her honor, where it chronicles her encounter with a large truck that led to Dr. McCarroll for a white stripe down the center of the road. She also made contributions to that community in other ways through her medical practice, and she started the first library in the Coachella Valley. So thank you, Dr. McCarroll. Next, we come to Catherine Blodgett, also from Chicago. She attended the University of Chicago, graduated in 1918, and went on to Cambridge University in England to obtain her PhD in physics. She developed a coating which results in non-reflective glass, which is used, of course, in automobiles. And remember Peg with her carousel Oldsmobile? Well, let's not forget, she developed child-proof windows and door latches in 1958. And remember Susan Vanderbilt? She designed the lumbar support seat. She also designed the very first child safety seat in 1961. And here's an actual photograph of it. Of course, today's child safety seats look much different. But she got the idea to actually develop one. And last but not least, advocacy. And we look to Candace Leitner for recognition. She founded the Mothers Against Drunk Driving in 1980, unfortunately, after she lost her daughter to a drunk driver. Now, since that time, drunk driving and impaired driving has not been eradicated, but it has been reduced throughout the world since she founded Mothers Against Drunk Driving. So where are we today with influencing buying, designing, and driving automobiles? Well, they're at the top. And we only have to look to GM, where Mary Barra was appointed CEO in 2013, becoming the first woman to lead a major global automaker. We also have pioneers at the Indy 500. But during the last two decades, only 9 women have participated in the Indy 500, including Simona DiSilvestro, right here on the left. She drove for Team Peretta in 2021. So ladies, there's an opportunity to still be the first woman to win the Indianapolis 500. And since 2015, Beth Peretta has run Grace Autosport. It's an organization established to promote STEM education for women through auto racing, science, technology, engineering, and math through auto racing. And in 2019, the Arts Center College of Design in Pasadena, California, received one of the first Helene Awards to celebrate excellence in the automotive industry, in large part for their program in transportation design. And during the last several years, the college experienced a 25% increase in the number of women enrolled in its program. Same goes for the Detroit College for Creative Studies. Their female and male graduates in this field are in high demand. So now we come to the Automotive Hall of Fame, which I've referenced several times throughout the program. It was founded in 1939 to recognize individuals who make a significant contribution to the automotive industry. It's a very high honor. And there is a brick and mortar location in Dearborn, Michigan. Now, there are over 800 honorees worldwide in the Automotive Hall of Fame, but only 6 are women, including Alice Ramsey, Denise McCluggage, Shirley Muldowney, Bertha Benz, Janet Guthrie, and most recently, Helene Rother. And if you have not been introduced to these ladies, I'm happy to be the one to acquaint you with them. And before I conclude my program, as I'm at the end of my didactic presentation, I want to give a special thanks to my automotive consultants, my husband and his cousin, and a special thanks to our host, the Palos Heights Public Library. Well, this concludes my presentation of Driving Forces. I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I've enjoyed presenting it. Thank you for tuning in.